My name is Will and this is Olia. We are professional filmmakers who jumped on a sailboat and are exploring the globe in search of inspiring stories and people along the way. We hope you enjoy this series, and if so, tap the subscribe button so you can follow our adventure. If you watched our last episode of The Adventure Locker, you'll remember that we filmed Alvaro, an incredible human attempting to circumnavigate the globe by sea-doo. And now, we're on our way to Mexico.
So, 3-day sail from here, maybe even shorter if we get good wind. So, fingers crossed.
Our intention is to leave our sailboat, Bonita, on her own in Isla Mujeres for a few weeks, as we embark on an incredible expedition slash production in Antarctica. This will be our third trip to the seventh continent, and we really want to share this special place on Earth with you.
What is it about dolphins? Every time we arrive to a new country, they come to greet us. They're like the greatest welcome we can have, right? Hola, amigos. ¿Qué tal?
Isla Mujeres is a heavily touristy place, which typically means overpriced. However, we were fortunate to meet a local family who were more than happy for us to leave our boat on their private dock for 3 weeks while we are away.
Too easy, huh? Too easy.
The following day, we flew all the way to Ushuaia, Argentina, located on the southern tip of South America and often referred to as the end of the world. It's also a gateway to Antarctica. And this is where our adventure really begins.
Ole is talking right now. So we are on a beautiful ship. The room is big, but then we understand that we have way too much crap. So now we're trying to figure out how to organize everything, so we're not going to jump for whole 2 weeks around, because I'm pretty sure that I'm going to break my leg. Good luck to us.
A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, we have now left the pier. Our expedition to the Antarctic Circle is officially started.
We're away. Goodbye, Ushuaia. Next stop, Antarctica.
To reach Antarctica, you must cross the Drake Passage, which is considered the most dangerous passage in the world due to the harsh weather conditions, strong currents, and icebergs. These factors have caused many shipwrecks and maritime disasters throughout history.
Crossings. The sea state can create havoc on the boat. Many become ill. By that, I mean puking karate. In a way, it's almost like a test you must pass before experiencing the glory of Antarctica. Like, how strong are you really? Good luck keeping your lunch down. This time, however, we were extremely lucky and had the following seas the whole way down.
We are on the MS Roald Amundsen, part of the Hurdy-Gurdon fleet. Hurdy-Gurdon is a Norwegian cruise company that is known for expeditions in polar regions. What makes them stand out is their commitment to sustainable tourism. This ship has hybrid electric power, allowing it to run solely on battery power at times, reducing emissions and noise pollution. By 2030, Hurdy-Gurdon is planning to have many ships that will be emissions-free. But the coolest part for us is the fact that they run a scientific program on board. The company partners with various research organizations to provide opportunities for scientists to conduct research in remote and pristine locations. It allows researchers to study everything from climate change to marine biology, and the data collected can inform conservation efforts and to understand our world better. While we were crossing the Drake Passage, we had a chance to meet Lauren and Blake, two researchers from the California Ocean Alliance who are the main reason we are here.
So our research is establishing a baseline of the health and behavior of many of these species of whales so that into the future, we can better inform management and conservation of all whales in the Antarctic Peninsula.
We're on our way to meet up with the whale team and see if we can go find some whales today.
During our first trip to Antarctica in 2018, we learned a lot about whales. They make their way to Antarctica during the summer months, typically between November and March, and their journey can cover thousands of miles, but it's all worth it. The nutrient-rich waters are abundant with krill, a small shrimp-like creature that forms the base of the Antarctic food web. Krill is a primary food source for many whale species and is high in protein and essential fatty acids. Pretty crazy to think that the biggest mammals on Earth survive on one of the smallest. Lauren and Blake have come here to Western Antarctica because it is one of the most populated whale habitats on the planet.
Over there, it's just blowing. The hump of two, simultaneously.
Proceed to biopsying mode. Basically, we're able to poke the whales with a little dart and sample a small bit of their skin and blubber, which allows us to look at their hormones and DNA. The whales can feel the dart a bit. We liken it to a mosquito bite for a human, so it doesn't really impact them too much, and they tend to return to the behavior they were doing before we biopsied them within a few seconds.
Once the guys are done collecting all of the data, they come back to the lab.
Ready. Holy cow, you really do get a piece of them, huh?
Yeah. It really does happen.
Just when I thought the guys had the best jobs in the world, we met Allison. I can't deny that she is a big time nerd. But a super fun one.
Whoa, look at it under
Fantastic
here.
Job. Look at that. Mm-hmm.
It's like cactus, little cacti.
Allison collects samples of Antarctic water and conducts various research studies, mostly based on studying phytoplankton.
So phytoplankton are super cool. They are single-celled organisms that live in the ocean. And the words just mean phyto for plant in Greek and plankton for drifter. So they don't have the ability to swim against currents. They just sit in the surface of the ocean using sunlight through photosynthesis. They make organic carbon and they provide food to all of the marine life in the ocean. They provide oxygen and they're also regulating carbon cycles at a global level.
Okay, for people like me who don't understand how the world works, could you please explain the importance of these little friends? It seems like they carry a lot of weight on their tiny shoulders.
So Antarctica, of course, has the penguins, and they come out on land to make their colonies and nest. And then you also have these giant whales that are migrating down specifically to come feed on krill. So the Antarctic krill is the keystone species of this environment. But the reason krill are able to survive is because they are eating the phytoplankton. So it's a very short transfer of energy. When the sunlight returns after a long winter, the sunlight triggers the phytoplankton to bloom. The phytoplankton are then eaten by the Antarctic krill and all other marine stages of life. And then when the krill are nice and happy, the whales, seals, penguins can all benefit from that food source. And then when they poop, they release iron into the ocean, and as a plant or a phytoplankton needs that iron. So because of this ability to migrate back and forth and come focus on feeding efforts down here, those animals can then spread that nutrients all around the oceans and keep this circle of life going.
This cycle is mind-blowing. You find yourself in the midst of the harshest environment on the planet, and yet the whole circle of life is playing around you before your eyes.
Super slow in the most beautiful place, and we see whales everywhere.
Think about the connectivity of the ocean and whales' role in kind of being an indicator species for the health of our oceans. You know, we're dealing with these highly migratory animals that are going to travel thousands of miles away from here. And so the research that we do here is not only going to affect their health as they kind of travel throughout the world, but it's also going to indicate and play a big role in, you know, the health of the oceans at large.
Blake and Lauren are researching whales while Allison is studying Antarctic waters. These are two completely different areas of study, but it seems they are tackling the same challenges. To gain a better understanding of our ocean planet and find improved ways to protect it.
So I co-founded a project called Fjord Fido, where we're looking at phytoplankton in the fjords of Antarctica. And through this ability to come down on expedition vessels, we can start gathering information about the first level of life.
I'm searching the world.
What do you hope to find?
Sometimes if there's more fresh water, we tend to see the smaller phytoplankton. So maybe in the 5 micron, we'll capture those smaller ones that don't make it in the bigger net. So.
And if you will find it here, what does it mean?
I think what's unique is that every time we can come south, sometimes these aren't sampled. Like you'll notice there's no research vessels here at all. So this might be the one sample that's taken from this area. And in past years, we've discovered potential new species that have never been documented before because we have been able to take samples regularly throughout the whole year. So we don't know what we'll find.
So you see a bit there?
Oh, lots. Look at the color here.
We then connect this information that we took from the water to satellite information from satellites revolving around Earth that are trying to understand the health of Earth. So we're, in a sense, ground truthing what satellites are also attempting to understand.
Antarctica is truly a special place for us. Every time we visit, our understanding of the importance of protecting this pristine environment grows stronger. Lauren and Blake give lectures on the ship. Allison shares her research with guests. It is clear to them that sharing their knowledge will help others develop the same love and appreciation for this ecosystem. This means more people will advocate for its protection. In the same way, we almost feel obligated to share what we've learned on this trip with you. Once we fully understand that everything is connected, we will see the world in a different light. We are extremely fortunate to have witnessed the beauty of Antarctica firsthand, and we hope to have captured a glimpse of it for you. Stay tuned for our next adventure when we explore the human history of the seventh continent.